For illumined life to be birthed into form, I am the truth, I am the light, illumine, beloved divine.
Hello there, everyone, and welcome to the sacred space here with me today. It's been a really long time. It's been quite of a journey since I've last spoken to all of you and shared some messages of not just what's coming through as, you know, messages of spirit, but my life. My life is an example. My life is a living example of Christ on earth. So since I've last spoken to you all, I've been, as you know, rooted and then uprooted in my previous sacred space, and it's been a journey of 7 years, almost exactly. And I thought, now this is it, right? This is where the new journey begins. But basically, since my uprooting and first move, because it was just a first move, it's like a whole new transition period began, right? And I couldn't expect, I couldn't foretell, I couldn't foresee that for some reason. That's, as you know, always divinely intended and orchestrated. So that was actually just the beginning. And I didn't realize that until the first time that after 1 week of moving, I realized I'm gonna have to move again. And then we moved around 2.5 weeks. Realized after 1 week that we're gonna have to move again. And it's a long story, and I don't want to go into details because that is a part of my private personal life. And in the last video, perhaps I did go too much into the details, but I wanted to sort of indicate the movement of light and dark. And I've realized since that they've become almost conjoined. It's like co-joined twins, right? They kind of like walk in this unanimous path. They're becoming more merged, melded as one. So it's difficult to tell. You know, in the past, it could have been more easier, like, to tell this is darkness and this is how it operates and this is how the movement of light feels like. Where I am now, which actually feels like being spit out and spun out into this living density of this world, this muddy, murky waters of life, that, as you know, this world isn't all love and light. It isn't always just pleasant. It isn't just a world made of light. It's a world of form that is being influenced by so many factors, right? The streams of life are infinite. So I don't want to go too deep into this video. I still don't have a good internet. I'm still in the go. I'm still moving. I'm going to have to actually move the third time now. Now imagine, we've had our own place before, which, you know, someone like me has a lot of things. I have a lot of stuff. I really have a lot of things. I think I counted like 5 huge boxes of oracles alone, and I have crystals and stones and shells and like stuff, you know, and these things mean something to me. And I can't just throw them away because life sort of now is more nomadic and gypsy-like and hippie-like. And it's just difficult because I don't want to go even into it. But in this last month, and it's almost a month now, and I've experienced so much trauma, so much pain. And remember in the last video, I've said, oh, no more crying. Well, maybe for the first few days, but life is really unpredictable. And this is actually where the tears really began for me. I came to the point when I nearly had a nervous breakdown, and it wasn't an inner state, you know, when people have psychosis, things like that. It was an oppression. It was such a deep, deep sadness, because what I felt was my living Christ essence. I saw it hovering above this lake, right? There's this area where we really feel myself to be, but it's like I couldn't live there. It's just impossible because it's so touristic and expensive and no places, and, you know, you don't know anyone. So it was like I had this feeling like the Christ just can't anchor. So besides just being deeply fatigued and tired, not just tired, you know, this was major exhaustion. Imagine being so exhausted that I ended up on the floor, dying, feeling like dying, begging for mercy because my body couldn't take it anymore. I was depleted of all life force. Imagine before I worked on cultivating this life force for almost 7 years. And then it all started waning and waning and waning. And it's like, what's happening? I just couldn't no longer handle this because the pressure was immense, the pressure from the environment. It's like they were showing me, spirit was showing me how I jumped now into the densest aspect of what this life is like. I entered into the living world, the form of matter, because before, you know, I was more distant. I just stayed a hermit there. And although I was already living, energetically feeling everything, and I still participating with the world, now the situation got very tense because I've actually left the home safety, right? This feeling of, even though it was crap, even though there was this darkness there and this dark portal, there was still some kind of a safety nest, right? And there was this space that you've created and held for so long, and all of a sudden it took courage. You know, people are still asking me, why did you move out anyway? Because you still didn't get your money. And it's a long story. I don't want to talk about it because it's my personal private choice, right? And it was a path, not just me, but we both of us just had to walk. And this third time you realize, well, twice we moved out of this desperation feeling like something just needs to happen or we're gonna die, because that's literally how I felt. And now the third time, the answers, the guidance we got was, this situation is actually serving us for this Christ embodiment. Because the first thing I got is that if the Christ wants to be embodied in the physical form, first, all of the human fears need to be surrendered. We all think we're fearless when we live in a safety zone, when we have our stuff, our daily routines, people we love, you know, the environment. We don't realize, we can't realize, because we're not pushed through the edge. And there's a lot of people living this comfort, and they don't even know how much this affects our almost like astral field, because there is this tendency how we always function in certain environments, right, in a certain way, because there's this astral tendency there that makes us function in a certain way. Like when I lived there before, I was always almost functioning in the similar way day by day, right, with slight differences. When I was thrown or spun out of, like spit out of that environment, it was like my life was no longer my own life. It felt like, who am I even? There were so many questions. There was physical challenges. There was feelings like, you know, we had a roof over our head. We had a bunch of stuff that were just like basically more of a hindrance than anything else. But we didn't have a real home. So it was this feeling of homelessness, you know, like this biblical story of this chosen, was the chosen people, and how they were wandering the desert for, I don't know, 40 years or something. It's very symbolic as well. And that's how we felt. So imagine moving, and all you're doing is packing, unpacking. There's like all this stuff. And the first time we moved, I already almost died of exhaustion. And that's another story for, you know, like piles and piles of videos, which I'm not going to go into. But then realizing after 1 week, you're going to have to do that again. And then realizing that you're going to have to do that again. It was like this, you know, it was like almost thinking, what the heck? Someone's playing with me here. And having this victim mode thinking, right, this is darkness, that's what they're doing to me, it doesn't really bring the salvation of what the Christ is, what this journey of the Christ embodiment is. So what happened was, I realized now with the third time, first of all, right, these fears need to be surrendered. And second of all the identities that you still have, and I still held a certain part of identity where I was before, when I was anchored there. And even if it's just like a slight connotation with something that we have, the Christ can fully anchor, because it requires complete surrender, complete fluidity, which we don't experience until we pushed into such extreme conditions that they're sort of recreating the kind of, I'm not going to say atmosphere, as you know, it's not the proper word, but it's kind of like a state of being that basically, it's like you would push a button in your inner system and that would activate a certain response within your physical nature, right? It's you have two ways. You have fight or flight, right? Which is usually, again, associated with death and tendencies of thinking, well, if this isn't like this, and if it doesn't resolve, the last thing you can do is just die, right? It's because there's no more exit point. And the second thing is, right, you fly, you ascend, you lift off, or you embody. At this point, what happened was during this transition point, because we were always in the go, there was feeling like being chased. And again, it's not like a negative connotation, but there was this feeling like of just needing to keep on moving. Like there was no stability. I wasn't anchored. So what happened was we met all these people along the way, and we've talked to random people and strangers, and this activated this Christ principle. And then on the last day, actually, it was just before moving for the second time, right? We came across this old bookstore, and it almost fell into my lap. This book just looked at me. It was this white book, thick book, with golden imprint. And it was another Gospel of Christ, but this prophet, this woman from Germany called Gabrielle. It's an amazing book. I haven't read the whole of it because of my situation, but I do plan on, because it's such a sacred book. It's like a living testament. It's like the real story. It's like the true version of what the Bible misconstrued and, as you know, recreated in its own way, an idea, identity, and what created the modern religions and churches, right? And it sort of goes along this path of revealing what the Christ truly is, right? And in one of these examples, because I read through the book, first few chapters, and it talks about how the Christ, what I call the cosmic Christ in the book, it's called the God of Christ or the Christ of God. I don't know, it's translated in English directly, but this aspect always finds a way. That's what the Christ is. So they gave one example how there were certain men chosen to write this transcript of the true word, but they didn't fall through. They came into matter, right? They got sucked into it, which happens a lot of times on earth. So what they show me is the true Christ, beings of light who came here to assist, they've actually chosen these extreme conditions so they wouldn't get nonchalant, lazy, falling into just, you know, this state of passivity. And that's why my life got so extreme lately, because Spirit just wanted me to really be, just really end up on the floor so the Christ could raise me up and I could remember, right? So this book came in handy just when I was at this worst breaking point. And I've experienced one breaking point after another in this last year. And I know that a lot of people right now are suffering and going through tremendous difficulties. There's also people who are staying at the fringe of it. It's not the same thing. It's not what the Christ path is about. As you know, there's a lot of oracle readers, tarot readers, people who just teach these things. It's one thing to mentally teach something. It's a whole other thing to actually jump into matter, because what I'm doing now, I'm meeting so many people, random people, beautiful people, people like here who have farms, the natives who work with the land, who love the land. And I'm talking to them and I'm realizing how they think, what they feel, what information about what's happening globally in the world stage right now, it's coming to them, it's meeting them, how they're perceiving it. I'm just talking to people, I'm just loving them. I'm loving the world. So they were showing me right now at this point, I can't have this work that I was doing within these spiritual circles and with all of you. And even on my page, Patreon, I can't work right now because I'm unable. I'm literally disabled in that term, you know, that term for a reason. And I do want to apologize to those of you who follow me or support me on Patreon, because I was doing work for 2 years there. And at this moment, at this summer, I just can't. I can't. I literally have no means. I have no energy space left. All I have to do is find a home. And in this path of walking this journey and searching for this next, you know, this next rooting, anchoring state, I'm actually doing this missionary path of the Christ. So what they told me today, what Spirit told me, because I was again remembering how Jesus is an exemplary of the Christ and what he came here to seed, plant, and activate, is like how he was speaking to people just as well, how he was talking to wherever he went and where the missionaries went with him, with the group. He talked to people because he was trying to activate this principle of love within them and knowing of unity and one God, one source, right? One creator, one loving force of all life and the spirit of life. And in this book, it's so beautifully explained what I myself also know Holy Spirit to be, this essence of life and everything being alive and thriving, pulsating with life. So it's just unanimous with my knowledge and knowing. And so I was thinking about that, and Spirit said, well, the masculine Christ principle is the teacher principle. So what Jesus, as in his example, did, he was teaching the people. What came to be there then at that point, in that era specifically as well, was that these people received that imprint. They received that within their hearts. So that was around zero, right? Timeline point. These people receive the Spirit of Christ. And in these 2,000 years, you know, many things happen. Ages came and went, and societies fell and, you know, risen again. And now at this time, what they told me is the feminine Christ is the one who now just awakens this, what the Jesus principle, the Christ through Jesus, actually activated at that point. So as you know, my life in the last year became all about this Christ. It's like everything before was just a preparation. And I'm having tears in my eyes right now because that's all that I'm anchored into, all that I think about. Even at my worst now, I'm just, they keep telling me, focus on that, focus on the bigger picture because it is different. I know a lot of you might be thinking right now, what's even the point of it? This world is messed up. But remember, we don't see the bigger picture. That's the one loving Creator does. We're all missionaries. We each have a little seed, a little stone that we came here to place in this great wall that is being built into what, you know, it's been referenced as the new kingdom, or the kingdom of heaven, or the new era. It doesn't matter, right? So it's easy to be on the right at the edge and observe, because I notice a lot of these readers, what they do is they make up scenarios from the cards they receive, the messages they receive, and it's all just very general, and it's all like standing at the, you know, it's like standing at the edge, and it's more like this observing what's happening, what those of us who came here with the Christ embodiment purpose, we came here to jump in it. We came here to be one with it. So what they show me, what Spirit of Life showed me, is wherever I go, whoever I meet, even if it's animals, I met two guard dogs today here, you know, with the part of the farming, and they're all alone. You know, all these, what these animals do, they provide service for these farmers. So they guard their herds, you know, probably because there's wild animals here, you know. So at night it gets scary. And it's the hills, you know, it's remote here where I am now. And these dogs were just there, and I just met them, and I just like pet them, like I gave them the heaviest petting of their life, and I gave them love. I gave them appreciation for being there and being there in the cage just so they could, you know, serve a purpose, and just showing them gratitude. At the end, they were so soft. They were just sitting there doing like, do more. And, you know, I smell like dog still, but it's like just this love in me is awakening with this hardest of challenges that I've gone through, and exhaustion and losing the identity of what I was before, how I climbed the mountains, how strong I was, what I was able to do, what powers I had, all of that. It's like being human, being one with the human realm, because before, you know, I was merging with nature and the elemental kingdoms and the elven life. And now it's more like I'm just moving into the human spirit, because the feminine Christ now, as I'm shown, this principle is reactivating this, what was seeded and planted, right, in those 2,000 years ago, what Jesus was doing. Because these people, it's like they need to be located. And these people are there, and they're not amongst the knowing ones. These people, they've already once received this imprint, so they know. And when it's their time, they would receive this impulse and this call. And we always think, well, these are the souls that, you know, this and that. Well, those of you who are here on this mission, you have your own thing. You have your own circle. You have your own knowing. But that there's people, these beautiful earth souls that already existed, that they keep on, they're here. They always are here. They have been here since that time of receiving this first call back. Now, they're just, what's happening is they don't need to be taught that. It's not a time. Now, the feminine Christ spirit is just, it's like reactivating. It's opening up that within them, which was already there. It's already in them. It's in their hearts. And it's in the animals as well. It's in nature. So what I was doing there for 7 years before, they were showing me I was helping the elemental realm and the elven kingdoms to remember those kingdoms, part of the earth. And wherever I go, it's so difficult for me as a person. Just thinking about my life in the last month makes me cry, because I have not received much myself as the self, as an identity, as a separate being. But as a bigger picture, I know it's different. And when I think about that, when I focus on that, I know that this is, it's the love I'm being, it's the love I'm seeding, it's the love that's reactivating. It's coming, it's calling out. And the only thing I still have left, I have very little time for just myself now, because we need to keep on moving, we need to keep on searching and going. Wherever we go and search, there's things happening and unfolding and people meeting. It's just, it's intense though, because I wasn't used to living life like this, as you know. I had my stuff, I had my routines, I had, you know, and being thrown out into the world like this, now I have zero routine, very little time just for myself. I could hardly hike this hill today, barely. And I have these situations and meeting people and their natures and like discerning it. And you know, meeting these people from the evilest of person to the most beautiful person, it's like just seeing through it and realizing where people are entrapping themselves and why, and you know, what they're choosing, they're choosing. But it's like every time something would happen and there's an unfairness happening or an unkindness, and we need to keep on moving because of that, it's like there's this feeling of injustice, right? This feeling of this is not fair, it's happening to me. If there's this sense, darkness cannot be overcome because you feel like a victim of it. Now this journey in this last third cycle that now I'm feeling, it must be the last one. You know, they say the third time's the charm. I do hope so. I pray that is the truth in my case, because I don't think my body could handle much more. And my mom actually had her ribs cracked. It's a long story, so it's been so much of a healing of the body, needing to heal the body, but at the same time we were pushed into the situation and it was just difficult, and it's physically draining as well because of so much packing. I'm packing this up, you know, up down. It's just a lot. And within that space, I've just cultivated something that before in that safe space I couldn't, but that already lived in me. It's not something I learned. It's not something you can read in a book. It's not given to you. It's not imprinted upon you by going to a reader or Akashic reader. Or, you know, people have these workshops now. You think you're going to learn something in 2 days. It's not how the Spirit of Christ works. So there is this spiraling pathway. Even though I moved out and I said, now I'm moving and that's it. And it wasn't like this. And the first time I said, I can't believe this is my life now. I can't believe I'm moving again. And this happened for the second time was different. I said the same words, but there was more peace behind it. And now I'm feeling myself, I'm totally at peace because there's literally no control. There's no more control. So for the anchoring of Christ, first, all human fears need to be let go of. And we still have them. We all have them. No matter how much you're trying to convince yourself or others that you're so awake and you're so enlightened that you don't have that. Well, if you were pushed into extreme circumstances, that would indicate how much of that is still there, because you'd literally be squeezed for that which is still inside. So until we're squeezed truly, we don't know, right? The second thing is, like I said, it requires a total void. It has to be zero identity left. And the third thing, there needs to be total surrender, no more control. And I still had control within me. I still wanted things to go my way. I still have a heart knowing, a knowing where I feel like I want to be, where I want to live. And yet it's not like from here to here. It's like a spiral. So when you embrace that, it's just a spiraling pathway and you start trusting again, it's almost like the resistance is gone. And darkness actually operates through this resistance because it manipulates us because we're resisting. So it finds these, we've been talking about this before, right? It finds these loopholes through which it can manipulate us into anchoring more confusion and thinking this is not for us or this is for us. And we get so confused, we don't know which choice to make. And then what happened in my case is because I realized I'm going to have to move now for the third time, was like, literally, I made a mistake, right? But when I explored all the events that happened during this time, it's like all this needed to unfold for specific reasons, for specific people, specific situations and life experiences, because they all together, they are a composure of this mosaic, right, that's being built, that the Christ is building through me in my own embodiment, the Spirit of Christ, right, the cosmic Christ essence. And it's just brilliant in a way when you think about it. But as a persona, you can get so agitated, and it's right, we do have fears, we have frustrations, we have exhaustions, because that's okay. We have a physical body, and sometimes, you know, we have a feeling like I need to scream out. I do the same. You know, when I nearly lost it that one day, that was actually at the place where we have a mental institution. We have this hospital, It's in the, around the mountains though. And we came to that spot. And actually, right when we were there, I lost it there in the forest. And only now, coming to this point here, I had a realization about where, when I was there, why I actually merged with that essence of that place. So Spirit was telling me, wherever you went, you were unleashing the energy, you were resolving, you were like clearing something. And I didn't know at that time, I just thought I'm a mini human walking, searching for home. And they said, no, that's the appearance of things. So that's my story so far. I'm not on the other side yet. I just shared with you the tremendous difficulties, the heartbreaks. We literally cried probably every day. One day we cried so hard, just grieving our old home and what we had there, because we had to. That was a part of the process. And then one night, because I told my mother, we were using these coupons we got in our country to stay here so they would support tourism in these challenging times. We took this hotel, mini private Alp tourism thingy. And I told my mother, I don't think I'm going to stay alive, because I literally felt I'm dying. I told her my life force is leaving me. I don't think I'm going to live for a long time. She cried so hard that night. And that's when her rib broke. Because 2 days before, we went to this whole other place where, when I was little, I had a weekend house. We had an old, super old weekend house there. And we met this man who was our neighbor and friend. And he saw us after almost probably 15 or more years. He was so happy. So he's a huge guy. He lifted my mom up. And 2 days later, the crying triggered the sadness, right? The depression feeling, the anxiety, the grief, right? And her ribs cracked, and it was a lot of trauma that we were processing together. But the one thing remaining is, she always tells me, she says, ride or die, I'm with you for life. And that sense of loyalty is just so much to me, you know. And when I go and I meet these people, and some people are so super nice, when they show me just a little bit of kindness, it makes me want to cry, because I remember that there's so goodness in people. And even though I was disappointed so many times, and people have tricked me and betrayed me and just took my money or our money, and then, you know, things happen. And I'm just thinking, you know what, who's the real victor here? You know, you're really victorious when you stop counting money, when you stop comparing, when you stop complaining, when you're just like thinking, it serves a purpose. And then you stop with that nonsense, and you come back to your center and you say, fine. And I'm going to be fine. And even if I die, you know, it's still just, you know, it, what I'm saying is, this fearless state, living from one moment to the next, is probably the ultimate gift that the Christ has been teaching for eons. And it's the essence of the cosmic Christ. And it's this love, and it's this surrender, and it's this infinite state of grace. So I'm still not on the other side. I hope that the poor internet will upload this video. And again, I want to apologize to all my beautiful Patreon supporters and those of you who still support me during this time that I can't work, I can't publish content. I'm very sorry, but I just can't. And I hope you understand from your heart why I can't. But I'm still living my purpose. I'm not somewhere enjoying a retreat and with my feet up, although I totally know I would deserve that, at least a month of that in this summer, because my life has been just constant movement lately, and it's been difficult, you know. I almost died 3 times this year, well, from last winter, as you know. And losing almost your life this way and then still living and trying to resurrect your body back, it's not a piece of cake. So I hope you do understand, and I want to apologize sincerely if you're still supporting me until I'm getting back in my feet, and when this cycle now where I'm in completes, because this is something that needs to happen, obviously. Then I'm going to be there. I'm going to start posting again, and I'm going to see you. And those of you who still support me during that time, I thank you so much, because I'm still working. It's I don't get paid for these things that I'm doing now, but it's work. And I know one day we'll all pay back in different ways. But I am thankful for those of you who support me unconditionally, not just when I provide something and share, because my essence is everywhere. And just call on me, I'm with you. And I've been living kind of isolated life. I haven't been in touch with anyone, maybe just very few people, but mostly it's just been us and this world and this physicality. And even when we talked we've invited the spirit of Jesus Christ one day, and he said, we're now in matter. We're really in matter, but this is all planned. It's how we planned it. We've chosen the, he literally said, there were many paths, and he said, you've chosen the more difficult one because you knew that it opens more doors. And I know that as a soul, you see this bigger picture. As a human, you don't always. And that's why you needing to keep returning, right? Keep returning to that state of the infinite heart of the Christ, especially at your worst days. And when I'm thinking about, oh, it's this, you know, people come and they keep telling you, well, now you have something with this, that's your lesson. I get so agitated. Well, I don't even get agitated anymore. I'm just like, let them think whatever they think, what they know, they think they know, and they don't actually. It's like Spirit always tells me, you did not come here to learn lessons. You came here to experience what it means to resurrect the Christ at this time, in this period, to be on this mission. And whatever density is happening because things are such and such on this planet. And even in that gospel, in the book, it says Christ did not need to suffer on the cross, still doesn't. But it's the consciousness of the people and this world and the suppression and the manipulation and control that causes this. Because just let me give you one example. Our country is so abundant. There's people who love the land, and then there's people who've sold out for money. And we've been talking to these people here now, how we as a small country, we've sold out because we have amazing resources. We have probably the kind of nature that not every country does. And we've sold out like little prostitutes. I'm sorry to say that, but it's this prostitution of the land and resources that exist as well. Because literally, right, earth is the feminine, right? So that is a part of the prostitution. So we thought we have the right to do that. And because of that, now what we have is people who are native here, they're disappearing, right? And it's British people or people from other countries who are very wealthy, who are buying these houses and these homes here, who are putting up these apartments, right, for rent touristically. These huge, heavy prices, you can't even imagine, at the expense of our beauty and the resources that these people who work with the lands from generation to generation. And this is prostitution, my dears, prostitution of earth and her resources. And it's difficult and it's terrible and it shouldn't be happening, but it is. And they've been telling me it's the world that is now that needs to be embraced. I know a lot of us would like to live in this parallel world where we're different reality. I have a parallel world that I know surely I'm also living there, because we're multidimensional and this world is more beautiful, and I'm by the sea and I have a beloved, and it's just different. I've dreamt of this place many times too, and I know how it looks. But yet here I am, I'm here, I'm in this country, I'm in these conditions, I'm having this life, this body, this way, these limitations in my body. And the only thing I can do is embrace this life, because that's what the Christ would do and does, right? So this situation that I want to give as an example is there are so many empty houses here right now, terribly amount, especially now with this, you know, global situation, empty homes, and even people with huge houses, no one upstairs. And I can't find a suitable home that would match my needs. Can you imagine that? No wonder I had this thing like my essence of the Christ was above this lake region here where I wish to be. And it's just like, it can't anchor. I saw it like hovering above, like searching. It was like searching. And it's difficult. So amidst all this, not being able to anchor, right? This search, being on a wild goose chase, probably, it's like Spirit took me on a ride. Spirit said, well, let's go on this. In the meantime, when this is not served yet, let's go and have this journey now. Let's go and have this experience. And let's meet this and, you know, walk through that and see these people, meet these circumstances. It's what it is. And it's totally different than, you know, just me doing cards every day and making up scenarios and saying, well, whatever resonates, resonates. Life is not just about what resonates with you. Life is about the reality of what divine source, as pure love, wants to create through us. And if the Spirit of Christ wants to be resurrected and alive again within the hearts of humanity, within this nature, within animals, we need to do something about it. And there's a lot of New Agers who are saying, this world is doomed. There's another better world, and this is just this prison planet, and it sucks, and this sucks, and that sucks. You don't know what Source knows. You don't have the kind of love that Source does, and all beautiful light beings for their creations, their infinite designs of life. So you end up acting this way and judging and being a false prophet of things that are not really true. So watch your words carefully. Watch what you're saying. Speak with love. And I know we would rather think of doom because it's easier to say it's already doomed than, you know, just still putting our input here and effort and persistence and perseverance, and takes courage for that. So anyway, if that has any meaning and purpose and it sits well in your heart, you're always invited to go to my page. You can make a donation as well. I never in the past few months have asked. I'm still not asking. I'm just saying, if you ever feel to make an energetic exchange, you're more than welcome. But my work on Patreon will resurrect, I don't know when, in this new, unknown, indefinite timeline. I don't know. I really don't know. But I do apologize to everyone who's just waiting. They're waiting. I can't. Okay. Literally, I can't. So I'm going to be with you all when I can. I hope this gets uploaded in divine timing, that I can have the proper structure to do so. In the meantime, I greet you with so much love. And remember, there is always a bigger picture. And if we don't see, doesn't mean it doesn't exist. So look with the eyes of love, and as always, with so much love, wisdom, and power for me. And hello from the hills for now, and I'll see you when I do. Hopefully soon. Bye for now.